So the next item, number 10, 620 10th Street, was just laid over this morning, so that's a last-minute layover. So we're going to jump ahead to item number 12, 203 Prospect Place, Prospect Heights Historic District, docket number 16-0973, block 1151, lot 66. A neo-Grec-style row house designed by Eastman and Dawson, built in 1885. This is an application for a certificate of appropriateness to construct a rear yard addition and alter the front areaway.
Which is partially obscured by vegetation. It's just a tiny little utility shed. And they're proposing to build a two-story rear yard addition that will extend 22 feet at the first floor and 15 feet at the second floor. The addition will be clad in brick and in stucco. The proposal also includes the removal of a concrete areaway steps to access the doorway under the stoop, and construction curb steps that will enlarge the basement level landing. And also you'll see in your handout too, a good illustration of the block that shows the existing rear yard additions that are there in that building space and how it compares to what they are proposing. We're going a little bit earlier than originally scheduled, so part of the project team is not here, but
My name is Matt Kaplan. I'm from Bowerbird Architects of Brooklyn. Partnership with my son Dan, who originally was supposed to give the presentation, arrived momentarily, hopefully. As Marianne indicated, it's a four-story house. The proposal is for a double duplex with the owner living in the lower half. What we propose to do is in the rear, a two-story tiered addition on the rear of the house, setting back the second story so as not to block sunlight from hitting the neighbor's houses or the rear yard, and create a green roof. We'll also renovate the front yard, enlarging the landscape area, replacing bluestone pavers where there is now concrete, and enlarging the stair to the basement level to allow for a generous and main safer entry into the house. Zoning restrictions in our proposed usage. The zoning for the project has been approved by the Department of Buildings, and the proposed addition utilizes far less of the amount of floor area and lot coverage that the zoning allows. In lot coverage, we're using 20% less than available, which means that the addition could be an additional 14 plus feet deeper. Additionally, we're using 939 feet less floor area than allowed. Why is it appropriate? Out of the 40 houses on this side of 203 Prospect Place, approximately half have an addition off the rear, not including the abundance of large rear decks. This proposal is in line with several previously approved additions in depth and is far less with respect to floor area due to a smaller second story. Four buildings to the west at 195 Prospect Place, a four-story addition protrudes 28 feet from the rear of the building. I think that would be that one. Can you show slide? Right, you can see it. It's rather enormous.
Can I just ask a question on that? And that, you might know better. Did that predate the district?
It was not approved.
Just checking.
Materially, brick has been used to reflect the nature of the adjacent rear facades, while a structural wall with stucco exterior has been employed at the center of the addition. A green roof has been added to the first story to provide energy savings, help with runoff, and replace much of the greenery lost due to the addition. Design and the dimensions. The dimensions of the addition result from carefully studied three-dimensional light models, which take into account the way shadows would fall on the neighboring buildings and yard at different times of the day and year. The rear of the buildings on this side of Prospect Place face north, such that the only time of day the sun hits the rear is early in the morning, after which it rises behind to the south, where the roof line envelops the entire proposed addition and beyond in shadow the rest of the day. Virtually no direct sunlight makes it to the level of the proposed addition from the west in the latter parts of the day due to the aforementioned four-story addition at 195 Prospect Place. By 20 feet wide. Wing walls extend beyond the rear wall, 2 feet 10 inches on the east side and 2 feet west on the west side, to support the overhang, provide privacy, and prevent weathering of the facade and snow piling up against it. There's a small shallow pool which receives overflow of the runoff from the roof above and redistributes it to the plantings in the rear. That would be the pool, and so it sheds into that and then distributes. And the green roofs being mentioned, you can see. The proposed second story includes 14 foot deep by 11 foot 2 wide new bedroom. So that would be the new bedroom. This is a second bedroom that is pushed out a little less. So the adjacent bedroom extends 7 feet deep by 8 foot 9 inches wide from the existing house, which is the least amount allowed in depth to satisfy the minimum outer court requirements per zoning. The remaining roof of one story shall be a green roof, which sits below the deck. This is the deck of the neighbor. This sits below that in height. That height is less than that, which sits below the deck of the neighboring house at 201 Prospect Place. The design of the second story was the result of zoning and light studies. at this point, I'm going to hand our presentation over to my son, Daniel. Okay, so what I've done, I've delivered these first two pages, pretty much all of the question.
Sorry, everybody.
No, we understand. It was the scheduling. It's okay.
Take a deep breath.
A glass of water.
Dad did a wonderful job, by the way.
Okay. I can't believe I missed it.
That's it.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, I missed some of it, so if I'm redundant, please excuse me. But essentially, the design of the place is based very much on a modeling of the direction of sun from early in the morning through the late day. And you can tell me if I'm being redundant, but I think it's extremely important to emphasize the fact that what we did was we built the 3D model, put in GPS coordinates, and timed that with a time-lapse video that we took of the rear yard throughout the day. We have photos from several times of the year that you'll see in the slideshow. And what it shows is only in the very early morning does sunlight come from the east and hit the proposed addition and cast a very small shadow for a very short period on the neighboring building here at 201. The idea was that we would cut back the addition. Actually, I have a laser. So the idea was that if we cut back the second floor and put the one bedroom here, and then we had to pull out this bedroom here just to meet the DOB and zoning requirements for 1.33 wide by one deep. So what that meant was if we cut back the parapet here, just to have a little overhang over the door, that the sun should essentially never really hit this building at any significant time of day. So the other part of this concept was, with the remaining level of that second story, we would build a green roof and save energy, collect the runoff, bring it down into the yard, and kind of replace a certain amount of the greenery lost due to the addition in the backyard. I don't know what else is missing, so perhaps with questions I could fill in any.
All right. I mean, I can understand that you want to be sensitive to light and air to the neighbors. I think that's typically not what the commission looks for in sort of appropriateness, but really about, maybe you can speak a little bit about the bulk itself, the
yes.
And how that relates to the character of the block.
Absolutely. So one thing we studied was, if you look here, this is the neighbor down at 195, four buildings to the west. That building comes out from our rear facade 28 feet and rises four stories. From that, we decided that is the closest one in view looking west. Although, if you look at the photos in this document, you'll see that beyond that building, there's at least a dozen other different size additions off the rears, right? So if that is the one that sticks out 28 feet, which is right there, you'll see right after it is a whole series that all interconnect of different depth additions. This one being very recently approved, this one not so soon before it, although that might have been pre-landmarks. And then right next to this is another one. So these two here extend 20 feet in to the rear wall, this one and the one next to it, which is right there. So you can see the dark brick one is the one that was 20 feet, and then that one also extends. And then it has a cornice that comes out over it that extends further.
Can I ask you a question on that while you're analyzing this? Have any of the ones on your side or on the other side that you know of that have been approved by Landmarks, been greater than one story tall?
Yes. These right here that I'm showing you are two stories. So this, I'm standing on the second story of this. I think you could see it well right there and right here. You can see?
So
these are one stories, and then these are the two stories.
So 175 is two stories?
Yeah. Here, if you take a look right here,
right.
This color means two-story. The lighter purple is two-story plus basement. The darker purple is two-story. So you can see there's those two next to each other. There are 20 by 20 with overhang, before the overhang. And then there's one down there. There's one here. There's that brick one that I think was quite obvious. And then this is the very large one. And we're told there's also a two-story that was just approved here before I could even get data on it to put in our slideshow. So, but you can see that there's almost continuous additions to that side. There's going to be one right here. There's going to be one right here, and there's one here. And this, though it's very hard to get very good quality resolution, you could see the series of them in the rear yard there. So you could see some rise pretty tall. Those are the two that we said were 20 by 20 by two stories. So honestly, one of the big things that we learned early on, because we knew the contractor working on this, we took a tour and got their experience, and we purposely cropped back the second story such that we wouldn't have as much bulk on the back. So that was a big driver of this, was not to fill out this large kind of cubicle solid, instead articulated a little bit to give a little more sculptural, interesting feel to the backyard while still using the native materials of the neighborhood. We're going to use the same brick that you see existing in the rear yards of these, and then we're going to plant it to try to integrate with some planting to a good amount, as much as can grow in a shadow. The whole key to remember is shadows are cast across this backyard for most of the year. So anything we can grow back there would be shade tolerant.
All right, questions? I have a question. One deliberate feature that you've done in your design is to have sort of projections over the windows. And I think if you look at the buildings overall, you don't see that feature. Right?
Well, usually, the cornices. I didn't put it in the rendering.
Well, it's not really cornices. It's they're okay.
So like,
they're kind of flat, right? They may have a lintel, but if you go back to the rear, all the windows are flat on the wall, and then you have, you know, lintel, and they're recessed. But what you have in your design is a very deliberate projection that comes out on all the windows. Our doors. So I'm just curious, that's an element that is not really seen, and
Well, if you look here on this edition.
Well, you show us like the worst example, but I mean, if you look at.
Well, I was just going to show you a few ideas, though, that we're trying to carry forward is, this is taken where I couldn't see above this, but with all the decks projecting out, the idea generally for, you know, to maintain the quality of a building is wherever we have doors and windows is try to protect them. Just with, on the upper floor, it's 1 foot of a projected overhang, which is kind of typical with the overhangs of the neighborhood. And then down on the bottom level, where the doors have to really swing open, it's extremely difficult. Where we grew up, it was the same thing, that if snow piles up and the doors swing out, can't really open the door, and even still, to have it pile up. So to keep the weathering away from that rear facade, just where appropriate, we wanted to do that. So if we were bringing glass far down, to have weather piling up against the glass is just, it's a very bad idea for the material.
Yes, Fred?
I just have a few comments. For my taste, the whole thing is kind of complicated, overly complicated for such a little structure. But I'm not sure that's my taste is the way to judge this exactly. I think in the rear we should give and have traditionally given a lot of greater freedom to an owner to interpret the design on the rear, as long as a few kind of guidelines are given. And I think top row of windows and that sort of thing is adhered to here. The one design item that I find that I want to just comment on, though, because, I mean, again, I'll just say I wouldn't design it like this, but I don't think that's the criteria. You have, and I think you have a right to do that. But I'm questioning that this one feature, design feature that you have, which is the stucco blade wall, is in stucco. And I'm not going to object to the overall design, but I do object to having such a feature be made out of such a a subservient sort of material. So I, for my taste, I would say I could go along with this scheme, but I would not go along with the stucco. Some other material, metal, copper, zinc, something like that, to make it more distinctive would be what I would like to say.
And that was precisely...
I just wanted to point out one thing. Why don't we try and have questions right now, because we're going to take testimony as well. And I believe there's actually going to be quite a lot of testimony, and we may have to sort of delay when we have that. Yes,
you can answer that.
Yes, you can respond to Fred's question, and then we'll take other questions.
Very quickly, because we've given this a lot of thought. Number one, the reasoning behind this was because we had to cut back here and not bring our second story straight across to a bearing wall here. We have to pick up a huge amount of load right in the center of our second story. What that meant was we have to get a lot of structure in this center wall here. In order to do that, we can't have that a masonry bearing wall very easily and get insulated properties on the inside. Otherwise, that wall gets extremely thick. So what we thought the best option was to get our load-bearing elements inside. And though, you know, in a rendering, it doesn't appear as realistic, the idea is, at this point in all of these brownstone neighborhoods, what you're looking at is stucco. Any of these buildings that have been refacaded in the last, 40, 50 years are all stucco. They're not brownstone. And so, though this color-wise isn't really showing you, we were going to pick like a darkish gray, which is actually quite typical for the area. And we think would add a very interesting element that's, I think, aesthetically appealing because it gives you some variety. Whereas you're looking at the rear here, this is most people's view of it. This looks very traditional in terms of the context. We put the windows at the exact same level as other windows on the other facades. We chose brick to match all the brick. Literally, and we're going to have bluestone parapets, bluestone yard. The only difference is from the rear, this one thin line of stucco. And only from an angle, which very, very few people through the trees and 130 feet of backyard could ever even see that
wall. Diana?
Thank you. Well, he may have answered my question. I also had a question about the stucco, but also just the appearance of, instead of, you know, a back facade, it's sort of like two facades almost, but obviously he's not able to bring it out square. But I'm wondering if it's maybe, it almost looks like they're two little buildings together, separately designed rather than integrated. But it may be partly the rendering. They are at the same elevation, correct, the two buildings? It's just that one is further back than the other?
These two? Yes. And part of that idea is literally to break it up, not to make it look so monolithic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously anyone could argue both one side or the other, but to us, especially looking at all of these, the ones that fully take the entire allowable zoning envelope look like these giant blocks to us that kind of land on the rear of the building, whereas to articulate it some breaks up the massing to a good degree, right? Like if we bring back this wall, then when these people come out, it's not so much right next to them on their deck. Then this is brought out a little more in just in terms of getting the minimum amount of space for a habitable room with a very small closet in it, and then still keep these back far enough where we can allow the light across. So they're all trade-offs. If we brought it all, you know, further out, we're going to, you know, block more light, we're going to have more massing. It's just a trade-off as far. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay, Roberta, you had a question?
Yes, I got two questions. One was that the green garden is just one half of the, right? That's what you were saying. So you were talking about not bringing out your the part above the door, the small part, because you wanted to get sun in, is that what you were saying?
Are we talking about this piece here or here?
That piece, that whole piece. Your idea was to get sun in, so that's why it's back?
Yes.
The overhang?
This cutback, which you could see best from like up here, shows you that if the sun is rising and you get any light here at all, we're trying not to block it from hitting the rear of this building. And then, honestly, what we did with this rendering was show the absolute worst case scenario very, very early in the morning, like 6:30 to 7, or 7:30 a.m. to about 8:45, 9 a.m. in the middle of summer is the only time you get this. And even these aren't real because it's such a low azimuth of the sun that I put as much of the block in as possible, but I didn't even put the buildings and trees in perpendicular to this on Vanderbilt, which is down this way. And when we show the time-lapse video, you get zero sunlight until it hits, you know.
So you're trying to make it possible for sun to come in. You're not.
We're doing everything possible based on the light study to block almost no sunlight at all from hitting that deck.
And hitting the adjacent neighbors, is that?
There's not.
What are you trying
sun,
to do?
No sun will ever be blocked from these neighbors.
Even your immediate neighbor?
This one.
Yeah.
This one, I'm showing the worst case scenario here. But you see there's still sunlight on the deck, right? So this is very early in the morning, only for like a few weeks of the entire year are you gonna get this extreme example. And I don't even think you'll get this because of all the trees and the buildings that are down the block perpendicular, that at such a low angle of the sun, you know, it's extremely minimal. We have a time-lapse video we could show of it, but you guys don't have time for that.
Right, and it's not really our primary consideration,
yeah,
as well. All right, Michael, do you have a question?
I had a question.
It was answered. Okay, any other questions? Can we take testimony, or should we bring them back for testimony?
There's no testimony.
I understand. No, my understanding is that the time was given for this particular item, and we put it ahead of time. So there may be people here who haven't shown up as yet to testify. So if it's okay with the commission, what we'll do is we'll bring this back for testimony because I believe there'll be a lot of speakers. So if that's okay, Sarah, we could just move on to the next topic. So we're not closing it. We're just going to leave it open, and we'll bring it back for testimony at the allotted time. Oh, is that okay? That's what we do. We can't just adjourn it till. Wait, but there may be other people as well. We're going to bring you back. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to close the hearing now. We will reopen it at the allotted time.
Okay.
So we've closed the hearing. Sorry about that confusion.
We're now going to go back to item number 12203, Prospect Place in the Prospect Heights Historic District. And again, this is a certificate of appropriateness application for a Neo-Grec style row house designed by Eastman and Dawson, built in 1885. The application is to construct a rear yard addition and alter the front areaway.
Yes, please.
Mary Ann, has that 203
presented a little while ago, and we're re-presenting, well, we're not going to re-present it, we're going to bring it back now to hear the public testimony and to hear your comments after the presentation this morning.
All right, we're going to take testimony. Let me just... Yes. Do you want to add anything?
Earlier in the presentation, there was a question about whether there were other additions within this block that had been approved by the commission. So Marianne has is just going to address that one question, and then we'll go to the public testimony.
Okay, great.
On this side of the block here, three additions have been approved since the district was landmarked. One of them was a one-story at 185, which would be over here. And then there was 209, which doesn't show an addition here. That was actually a two-story brick-clad addition that extends 14 feet into the yard, and then 175, which is here, you can see that, that part, and that was also a two-story brick-clad addition. It actually extends out 22 feet into the yard, and the second story is set back 4 feet back at 18 feet. So I just wanted to give you that background.
All right, we'll take testimony.
Yeah, I got it.
Right. Peter E. Johnson.
Hi, everybody. My name is Peter Johnson. I'm going to be sharing some images just to kind of balance out what everybody's been seeing here. I and my family, we live at 201 Prospect Place. We are the immediate neighborhood, the immediate neighbors to the left of the proposed extension 203. The red area here shows where the extension is going to be. The combined backyards that compose the eastern half of our perimeter block are especially lush, spacious, and deep. I value their beauty and the open air, sunshine, and wildlife that this ecosystem provides. It is not that typical of a perimeter block quadrant in that it hasn't been built over. In fact, it is relatively untouched by time and in this respect and unique in its historic character. I would hope that the commission might consider this green space to be as vital and historic a feature of the community as are the houses themselves and the people who live in them. Only considering FARs and the square footage and doing what's allowable can override other precious considerations. And in fact, this image was one of the key images which actually convinced us to buy the house, the fact that we had this amazing, lush back garden. Our particular garden structure was laid out by the renowned architect, George L. Morse, who is also the architect of our Romanesque Revival House. He founded the AIA and built many famous Brooklyn landmarks. We have enjoyed our garden over the past 18 years as much as we've enjoyed living in our house. Both possess beauty in their elegant proportions of design. Should this extension be built in my neighbor's backyard, the garden sunlight will be compromised. I know you've seen some studies, and we could disprove a lot of that with the photographs that we've taken of how the actual sun comes into our back garden. Dan Kaplan, the architect, claims that no early morning sunlight penetrates our yard. The photos here clearly speak otherwise. I can see the sunrise from the kitchen door leading out to our deck, spring through late October. He claims he's done these shadow studies and there will be minimal effect. But considering the extension of 195, which is just four houses to the west of us, the garden shadow it creates in the morning, I think it's clear that an extension that is 22 feet deep even though it is lower, will have an almost equally intrusive effect, not to mention creating the funnel experience for the three houses potentially sandwiched between them, my house being one of those three. And this is a Google shot. You can see the shadow that's been cast from the 195 extension. Dan Kaplan also claims that 203 already has an extension and that 50% of the houses are possible.
I'm sorry, your time is up, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Donald Campbell?
Hi, Don Campbell, my wife and I live immediately adjacent on the other side at 205 Prospect Place. My principal concern is the overall quality of the neighborhood that includes our own life, the people who are adjacent to the house at 203, and the rights of the people at the house of 203 to make use of their property within parameters that don't really impose and impinge on the life and the lifestyle of others. I would encourage the designer and the homeowners to consider reducing the profile and the extension of the house. It currently reaches back over 20 feet, which would be anomalous to anything else in this portion of the block. And it just, it will impose a pretty large wall immediately on our property line, which, you know, will change the quality of life for us. We use the outdoor space very much as an auxiliary to the house throughout spring, summer, and fall. And that said, my greatest concern is to see the neighbors and the neighborhood work together on this, because I'm convinced that the homeowners at 203 are going to be our neighbors for the rest of the time that we live there. I don't want this to be the kind of issue that becomes divisive in the community, and that's why I have had conversations with the homeowners, and I continue to encourage them to just rethink the design so that it meets their needs, but also respects the fact that by building this, they're capturing light, capturing views that other people have and will lose, and that they then take up. It's, you know, it's an emotional issue, and that's our side. So thank you.
Thank you. Kathleen Shapiro.
Hi, we represent the voices of over 100 concerned neighbors in Prospect Heights who would like to express our concern and voice our opposition to the proposed rear extension at 203 Prospect Place. 108 people in the neighborhood signed petitions to oppose this extension and to preserve the green space. We supplied copies of the petitions to the LPC. The community is clearly against this extension. As reported in the Brooklyn News blog, Brownstoner Community Board 8, in its decision on October 9th, upheld the housing subcommittee's vote against this extension. The proposed extension would materially reduce the green space, light, and air for all the families on the east side of the Prospect Place St. Mark's Donut Hole, representing the block's combined yards. As maintaining open green space is an integral part of maintaining the quality and character of a historic district, the proposed extension runs counter to the philosophy of the LPC's efforts. The proposed extension would cause quite a disruption to the Garden Corps urban oasis. This Garden Corps has remarkably few incursions, and in fact, no incursions on the east side of the Green Donut. Where there are any, primarily on the other side of the block closer to Carlton, most appear to be original extensions for kitchens and other service rooms. This historic Garden Corps is an important part of the quality and historical character of this landmarked block and contributes a special sense of place. One of the unique characteristics is the unusual depth of the yards, 131 feet. Instead of viewing the depth as additional leeway to build out, We believe this aspect should be considered part of the unique historical character of the Garden Court and should be preserved. In addition, the proposed extension with its solid brick walls would result in an oppressive, stifling feeling for the households immediately adjacent to 203, as well as those families several doors down in each direction who would look upon a brick wall where there was once open sky. The proposed extension would also adversely impact the neighboring historic gardens by blocking needed sunlight. We urge you to hear the many voices of the community leaders and residents in Prospect Heights and vote against this proposed extension so that the quality and character of our landmark neighborhood can be preserved.
Thank you. Andrew Shapiro, I believe you're reading for him.
Yes. My wife and I are homeowners who live two doors to the left of the proposed construction. In addition to the usual considerations related to a rear extension in a historic district, one particular aspect of this situation deserves special consideration. Because of a massive four-story pre-LPC extension from the 1920s at 195 Prospect Place, the proposed extension at 203 Prospect Place, three houses down, would create a tunnel effect for the homes in between at 197, 199, and 201. These households would be looking at brick walls on both sides. While we cannot do anything about the pre-LPC extension on the left, the LPC can play a vital role in preserving the character of the neighborhood by voting against this proposed extension. We are extremely concerned that if the LPC approves the proposed extension, such a decision may serve as a perverse, slippery slope precedent for future construction, resulting in the eventual obliteration of the historic quality and character of the Garden Court. The next homeowner may point to a prior approved extension and urge the LPC to follow it. What if everyone or nearly everyone in the neighborhood wanted to build an extension by pointing to a prior decision as a precedent to follow? The Garden Court would be destroyed and some houses would be sandwiched between brick walls in tunnels. Indeed, given the fact that nearly all extensions on the block predated the LPC's formation, any additional proposals for extensions should be scrutinized even more carefully to make sure that the historic character of the Garden Court is not further compromised. In particular, prior misguided actions by individual homeowners before the LPC's formation should not serve as precedents to follow, but rather reminders of how important the LPC's role is now in shaping the future. In addition, as for any prior LPC decisions to approve any rear extensions in Prospect Heights, we urge the LPC to consider whether they were fully vetted in the community. It seems that we have reached a tipping point where residents are only now waking up to the deleterious effects of encroachments into the historic green space. The fact that over 100 concerned neighbors signed petitions clearly shows a high level of concern and interest in preserving green space. Although the composition of the LPC may have changed since its decision to vote down a 15-foot two-story rear addition at 115 Lincoln Place in Park Slope in late 2013, we urge the LPC to consider the logic in that case. Just as in this case, the neighbors to 115 wanted to preserve the block's cherished green space, which provides light and air and a special sense of place to its residents. The LPC recognized that this Park
Slope
does measure up to the standards of unique, noting that it has the feel of a commons.
Okay.
And we believe the same is of our space as well.
Okay, thank you. Knud Erik Rosenkrantz.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm the owner at 207 Prospect Place. I've been a long-term resident for 28 years. So I'm two houses east of the proposed project. And I'm objecting to the proposal because of the impact on the views from my home and my garden, and also because of the precedent it would set in allowing further additions that would encroach on the very unique backyard green space on the block. This proposed two-story addition at a depth of up to 20 feet will block views of the open space between my garden and the garden at 197 Prospect Place. There are already several one-story decks on some of those buildings. They are shown in the picture we see right up there. But none of them, none of the decks go up two levels from the ground, and none of them have more than a small shed underneath. There are no additions in masonry or concrete. The proposal would create a precedent for two-story additions, of which we currently have none, on the entire row of attached houses from 197 to 223 Prospect Place. So that is three houses to the west of the property and 10 neighboring houses to the east of the property. Those 14 houses have their north facades approximately aligned with each other, and consequently they enjoy garden views to the north, east, and west with only minor obstructions from decks one level above the ground. And none of those homes currently have any two-story addition. I heard the presenters earlier talk about how on this block maybe 50% of the 40 houses have additions, but if you look specifically at this end of the block, these 14 houses, there's only one-story addition, and the rest are small sheds or just decks supported, open decks supported by steel posts or wooden posts. This proposed two-story addition in masonry and concrete would be more invasive of the green space than anything that exists in this row of 14 townhouses. I want to say, just like some of the previous people who have given testimony, is that I find it very important to preserve the quality of garden
spaces. I'm sorry, your time is up.
So the precedent in terms of preserving the garden space is very important.
Jay Crockett? Jay Crockett here? Yes.
Yes, thank you. I ask that the Landmarks Preservation Committee consider a larger issue, although it certainly applies to this current proposed project as well. There seems to be a huge contradiction between the objectives and policies of various city and state agencies. Even 1/20th of an inch of rainfall can overwhelm our city sewer system, sending a toxic mixture of rainwater and raw sewage into our water because our treatment plants cannot handle the volume of 1/20th of an inch. Every year, 27 billion gallons of combined sewage overflows pollutes New York's harbors and waterways. Gowanus Canal alone gets 377 million gallons a year of this combined rainwater and raw sewage. And that's in a normal year, not a Hurricane Sandy year. Initially, and I think that was 95 or 96, $2.4 billion was committed to building what was originally known as the Green Streets and now referred to as Green Infrastructure, which is overseen by the New York City Department of Environmental Protection and the New York City's Parks Department. Anywhere they can, even tiny, tiny pieces of formerly impervious space are dug up and planted with plants and trees to help absorb rainfall that would otherwise end up mixed with this raw sewage and dumped into our waterways. Tree pits have been enlarged. Even tree pits help the cause. All those tiny spaces add up, and they know this. Why then does the Landmarks Preservation Committee allow homeowners to cover up our private green spaces? An extension means that more rainfall from the extension's roof will flow right down the drain pipe into the city sewers. One might say, well, it's only a tiny extension, can't do much harm. Yet if one row house can build an extension, then so can they all. And just like the tiny green street plots, they all add up. Another contradiction is that an additional benefit of Green Street's program is that it improves air quality for all New Yorkers. And paving over a portion of the backyard to build an extension, although unseen by all but the neighbors, does the opposite. There's been a commitment, obviously, in the city to planting more and more street trees. Why do taxpayers plant trees in the street when homeowners get to knock them down where they can't be seen? Why, indeed, is the Landmarks Committee undoing, in a way, what the DEP and the Parks Department are spending millions to do? It seems to me that is what is given by one hand is being taken by the other.
I'm sorry, your time is up.
Thank you.
Catherine Appleby.
Hello, my name is Catherine Appleby. I live at 201 Prospect Place. If we allow this to be built, it opens up a floodgate for overdevelopment and sets a precedent for the next homeowners to build out to maximize their investments. Dan Kaplan claims that 203 has an extension and that 50% of the houses on Prospect Place have extensions. This is simply not true. There are actually 9 extensions on Prospect Place. As defined by Landmarks Preservation Committee, extensions have foundations, and Dan is counting utility sheds as extensions, and 203 has a utility shed. In the entire perimeter block, including St. Mark's Avenue, there are 92 houses, and in total, 15 possess extensions. On Prospect Place, half of the extensions are one-storied and no deeper than a deck. I would like to add that I am a mother of a special needs child and rely on stepping out onto my deck to breathe fresh air, scan the vista, and decompress, to find the mental and emotional fortitude it takes to function. I have no help at home, and my husband most often works late. We rely on our ground floor tenants for income toward our mortgage, our daughter's school, and therapies. If you'll notice, there are no real wooden fences there. They're chain link fences. This is a misrepresentation. There's light that spans right through. If this extension is built, the entire tenant's apartment will be in darkness, and I'm afraid no one will want to pay the rent it has afforded us. My neighbors at 203 have several options other than what they're proposing. As they plan for their futures, shouldn't they consider their neighbors' futures as well? Also, variances are supposedly allowable only when the original use, enjoyment, and character of the neighboring properties are not deleteriously affected. But this proposal would gravely affect my family's enjoyment and use of our property, and in so many ways alter my sense of privacy and the character of my house and backyard and all the surrounding backyards of this eastern portion of the Donut Core. Does my property, as well as many of my neighbors' properties, have to be blighted by another's real estate venture and desire for higher investment returns, meanwhile decreasing the value of our neighboring properties? Is this the wave of the future we want for our historic neighborhood? This does not adhere to the original intent of our historic green space. Please consider setting a precedent for the values of historic preservation. The green space was originally intended to be shared by all, with few fences breaking up the land. It was totally green. Let's protect,
I'm sorry, your time is up.
Let's protect the remaining beauty that is still at the heart of this communal heritage.
Your time is up.
Enjoyed by all those who live there.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right. The next speaker is Linda Harris. You're speaking for her?
Yes, I am.
All right. I just would like to let people know that normally if a person cannot attend, they should just submit their testimony in writing. However, I believe there's some confusion. Catherine Appleby, do you want to speak? Okay. So if you want to read into the record, Linda Harris, but in the future, just submit testimony to us.
Okay, very good. I came across the word commons recently. It refers to what used to be considered the right of all to share air, water, land set aside for food production, water use, and enjoyment of the land. Our backyards are private, yet an argument can be made that we share the commons of life, nature, views, air, natural habitat for species, space for growing flowers and vegetables. As wilderness areas are preserved and protected, so should this tiny oasis of urban wilderness that we are privileged to live around be protected. Many of us feel a most sacred connection to the land that is in back of our buildings. Is it not a serious oversight that historic designation for this neighborhood should not extend to protecting the park-like atmosphere that we have behind our houses? The green views, the earth that was set aside many years ago to go with the houses, certainly is part of the original design, and tampering with it by building obtrusively into it certainly changes the original designs and intentions of the architects whose historic buildings we are careful about preserving. Why aren't there better protections to keep our backyards as they were originally designed? Why should priority be given to new owners who have more space needs than the buildings were designed for? Do we need to appease people who find 24,000 or 32,000 square feet inadequate? Our housing stock is historic, including the exterior shape and structure. Buying into an historically preserved neighborhood should come with guarantees that we will all not lose the beauty and serenity that we now enjoy. It is what makes our backyards unique and, yes, historic. We need to take notice of the discomforting trend. More new owners are applying for extensions, protruding into their neighbors' light, space, sun, views, and privacy. We are drawing people of means to our neighborhood, in part because of our status as a historically preserved neighborhood. If we continue to grant new owners permission to extend the living space, what are we saying about respect for the original design of the neighborhood? And isn't this then a case killing the goose that laid the golden eggs? Thank you.
Thank you. Catherine, you're reading for one more person. Leslie?
Yes, thank you.
Leslie Feder?
We are new neighbors on this beautiful block of Prospect Place and want to be good neighbors to all. A primary reason that we bought our house was the remarkable open space within the block, the extra long lots, and the fact that the block has low landmarked buildings all around make it a large and continuous shared landscape environment. It has very few intrusions beyond decks. Our house has a large extension. They are at 195. But it is the four story. But it has been there for at least 60 years. That was started in 1927. The landmark protection of the block, both on the streetscapes and within the block, is critical. Any large new building in the garden space, as is proposed here, affects not only the immediate neighbors, but everyone who lives around this precious enclave. If each building's bottom two floors were extended 20 feet, the whole shared space would shrink. This is precisely what landmarks protection should prevent. We hope that the Landmarks Commission will not grant a variance to this dangerous precedent within our block, and that our neighbors at 203 will reconsider their design. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Joni Granville?
Good afternoon. I'm chairperson of Housing and Land Use for Community Board 8, as well as the chairperson of the Community Board. At the October 9th, 2014 Community Board 8 general meeting, members voted 34 in favor, one opposed with one abstention to deny the application for a certificate of appropriateness for the above location. The plans presented to us included the following details: widen the entry steps below the front stoop to allow for safer egress, demolish the existing ground floor rear extension and replace it with one that will be larger by 18 feet with a 3-foot nub wall for privacy, and add a 6-foot by 8-foot 9 extension to the second floor to provide a 4th bedroom while allowing for a separate rental apartment on the ground floor. This second floor addition would not include a deck. Air conditioning units would be placed on the roof of the second floor extension. Several neighbors voiced their concerns regarding the plan's encroachment into their light and air, as well as into the shared green space represented by the block's donut hole, as well as what some believe to be a miscategorization of foundationless sheds as existing extensions. We believe that the preservation of green space in our historic communities is of utmost importance and hope that you will ensure that it is preserved. We appreciate the opportunity to comment on this important matter. If you have any questions or require additional information, please do not hesitate to contact us. Sincerely, Najani Granville. Thank you.
Thank you. Barbara Zay.
Barbara Zay of the Historic Districts Council. HDC finds the proposed rear yard addition to this row house to be sympathetic in its overall size and massing, as well as in its inclusion of punched window openings. The committee felt, however, that the concrete structural wall, concrete and stucco structural wall contradicts this effort, since the gray color is a stark contrast to the red brick and could read as a strange and bulky gesture. Thank you.
Thank you. Patty Hagan.
Good morning, Landmarks Preservation Commissioners. I am Patty Hagan, a 35-year resident of what is now, thanks to you, the Prospect Heights Historic District. With landmarking, we believed much of Prospect Heights to be safe from the destructive ravages of overdevelopment. So it is ironic to be asking the LPC today to re-preserve one of the fundamental features of our historic district, the park-like green space that is and has been the shared interior of our block since the 1870s. The historic district's residential back parks are threatened by new owners on the block, 203 Prospect Place, who propose a massive 23 foot by 12 stories out and up extension. Oddly, they have just spent millions of dollars on this large brownstone that is apparently too small for them. Remember, St. Jane Jacobs warned of the destructive power of cataclysms of money. Instead of buying the right-sized house to begin with, they bought and proposed to massively intrude 203 Prospect Place into the historic rear garden space. 203 Prospect Place happens to be sandwiched between longtime friends and neighbors at 201 and 205 Prospect Place. Peter Johnson, Catherine Appleby, and Catherine Amendolara and Don Campbell, who spoke earlier, are gifted gardeners all. Their gardens have been featured attractions on the Brownstone Brooklyn Garden District spring garden tours. Gertrude Jekyll would have been at home in Catherine Appleby's charming garden at 201 and quite taken by Catherine and Don's working railroad routed around a volunteer peach tree rescued years ago from a vacant lot in Williamsburg. The hulking ahistoric extension proposed for 203 would obviously intrude into the rear shared historic green space that allows daily quiet enjoyment of nature to people living in Prospect Heights. Such an overwhelming add-on would prevent the sun from falling to earth in the enchanted gardens on either side of 203, casting them into Stygian gloom for much of each day, stopping photosynthesis. When new people choose to buy into an old historic district, in an age of rampant teardowns, one assumes it is because they want to live in history. For the Landmarks Preservation Commission to deem the 203 Prospect Place extension proposal appropriate would be to weaken the landmarks law. We, who feel protected by landmarks, trust the LPC to enforce preservation of this special place, Prospect Heights, front and back. Otherwise, Landmarks Preservation opens the floodgates to Trump-sized extensions by all the millionaires suddenly cashing in on the Prospect Heights Historic District. Please, Landmarks Preservation Commission, issue 203 Prospect Place a certificate of inappropriateness. Thank you. And I would also footnote that, oh, my time's up.
Okay, Christabel Goff. Christabel?
Christabel Goff for the Society for the Architecture of the City. I'd like to add a historical perspective to this. The reason this item is here is significant in your consideration. For many years, the additions like this would not have come to the commissioners. They would have been approved at staff level. After numerous passionate protests by large groups of neighbors, such as you have heard today, mostly in the Brooklyn Historic Brownstone districts, the commission adopted a new rule which caused them to look at additions in largely unspoiled center cores. This is one of those. There has been a widespread hope that additions such as this would be held to a different standard and would not be approved in a neighborhood like this. We share that feeling. I spoke of the Cobble Hill neighbors earlier. They campaigned for decades to get this rule, and they were hoping that it would have the effect of preserving the central cores, which you have heard so much about. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any more speakers? All right, we also received a petition from neighbors in the surrounding area. I can't tell you how many it is, but it seems like a lot. So, 108? Okay, thank you. All right, you'll get a chance to respond. I just want to make one comment on the issue of light and air, that in general, light and air as a land use policy is governed by the zoning resolution and not really by landmarks. And there are certain rules which require a minimum of 30 feet in your rear yard. There's a general proposition that each rear yard gives light and air to the own home. However, there's a respect for having 30 feet and then 30 feet on the other side of the donut to have 60 feet between home to home. I just want to comment on that because there's been much testimony about light and air issues, which typically is not really before us. And I think we get our guidance from our designation reports, and our designation reports may or may not talk about whether the garden itself is historic and therefore should be given a different kind of attention. I think Christopher talks about historically where you'd have enlargements in the rear yard that were not viewed in the public realm at all because it's all in the private gardens and were not really coming before the commission at all. They were done at staff level. So I think I just want to clarify to people the issue of light and air is really not what we are going to be analyzing as a part of this enlargement. Okay. If you'd like to respond, it's in a series of questions and issues were raised.
So first, I just want to address the idea of precedent that this neighborhood has only been landmarked since 2008, which was during the recession. So I imagine not many applications were made at the time. But more recently, two buildings on this side of the street, one right next door to, I think it was Mr. Anderson who spoke, was just recently approved right here. The property that we're talking about building an addition on is right here. So this one was approved as a two-story addition. Additionally, this one right here was also approved as a two-story addition, 22 feet on the first floor, I think 18 on the second story, and there's an existing one prior to Landmarks right next door to that. Whether or not these additions were all approved by Landmarks, obviously they weren't because it's a fairly new landmark district. But when our clients purchased the house and looked at the nature of the block and consulted with, you know, experts in these areas, they learned that with the abundance of rear additions, whether landmarked or not, it showed a great precedent that over 50% of this side of the street already has additions. Additionally, with regard to the zoning and light and air, I just want to emphasize that a tremendous amount of effort was made before we even knew opposition from neighbors of any kind to articulate the entire addition of this building to try to respect as much as possible the light and air, and you mentioned a 30-foot minimum of rear yard. We're leaving 53 feet at the first level and 60 on the second level. In addition, I agree 100% about the runoff issue and environmentally sound design. I think it's a major issue, and I insist with clients who propose rear additions that we do things like green roofs, which we are doing, and taking excess runoff and capturing it and reusing it in the rear yard. So we will not be adding. And personally, I think it should be a requirement of Landmarks and the Department of Buildings. So I think that I agree with that, and I hope that's understood, not just as an aesthetic thing, but it saves energy for houses and it deals with runoff, which is all very important. With regard to fences, I just wanted to show that if you look at photos of the existing yards, you can see, I'm going to show you this one is right next to the house. So if this is our proposed area of addition, there are a lot of fences. And if you look at the neighbor at 201, this is already very built up with their deck and vines growing, and they have a spiral stair, and that deck sticks out quite far. And I just want to show that if you look here, their building sticks out 5 feet from 203, the house in question, and then their deck and stair go out more. With an allowable addition, we would only propose to take the addition out to the extent of that deck, which is the primary driver of this design. We could have gone much further, I think another 14 feet further, but we were purposely trying to keep it in line with these decks and the light below. And whether or not this was approved here, a 6-foot high fence along that wall plus their deck would block virtually all of the light from below their deck regardless. So the effect on that neighbor would be very minimal. I want to make it very clear, I've heard talk about the proposed use. The idea in terms of the expense of these houses now was our client came to us saying the only way we can afford this project is by keeping a duplex, which it's already got the certificate of occupancy for the upper two floors so that they can rent that out and be able to afford to live in the lower two stories. In order to do that, they needed a little extra space for their family. They plan to live there for the indefinite future and to be as good neighbor as possible. We sat with neighbors and tried as best as we could to convince them of the merits of this, and have been willing to hear different comments and try to explain how light, even if it's not in your jurisdiction, how it would hit, and that the emphasis of our design was on that. And partly, we're even willing on the side of the neighbor with the longer wall to work with them in terms of building in trellises, greenscaping, lighting, whatever we can. I grew up in Park Slope. I've lived there for 40 years, and my family's lived there far longer. I am very familiar with the neighborhood. My father has worked for people in every landmarked area or not throughout Brooklyn. We're very sensitive to these matters, and I don't think it should be overlooked that, you know, what we could have bitten off was far less than what we've proposed, and that we're trying to be as sensitive as possible, but dealing with the new economics of a neighborhood like this. I think in part, you know, when I grew up, we grew up with a house almost the exact same conditions as what we're proposing, where our neighbor stuck out 5 feet and had an addition sticking out far further. We built trellises and lighting and we made it a nook, and we had far less backyard space than what we are proposing now.
Okay. All right. Are there any questions? Yes, Roberta?
I think you just that the architect just explained that he was only building out as far as the deck that exists there, but it looks like it's farther than that.
Right here, it goes, well, you see the deck comes out there and has the spiral stair, so we aligned this piece. This, only the overhang. Mind you,
So if the overhang was back, it would actually align.
If the overhang aligns with the spiral stair, and then the rear wall is actually significantly further back, that's 18 feet out. We are doing, and I wanted to answer a prior question also about overhangs. I just want to mention that when you look at the rear facades of these buildings, I'm sure you all know it very well, but just for those who don't, the developers of the time spent very, very little to no money on the rear facades. The use of the backyards were mostly given to outhouses and to staff. They didn't have parties back there. They gave very little thought, obviously, to what it looked like in the rear. But if you want to think about the precedent for overhangs, if you look at the front of buildings in the neighborhood, they all have very large cornices. They all have very large lintels over the windows that overhang to protect recessed doors with very large openings, such that, very intelligently at the time, you wouldn't get weathering up against the openings of the building. What I think we're proposing is very much in line with that, to articulate those openings and to protect them from the weather.
Okay. Yes.
But if you did not have that piece of masonry that comes, the sticking out that comes all the way down, and that over, or you could have for shading some device that's not solid, not, you know, not just a solid overhang, then you get more light in the, I think, in that neighbor's yard. You know, like the side yard that's sticking out beyond where the glass wall ends on the short side, right?
Well, so the argument we're making there is that we cut this piece back in order to not block any more than their deck already does. Then the way the sun works in this rear yard, and I promise you, we've mapped this directly to GPS. By the time the sun really hits the rear yard, past, let's say, 9:30 a.m., any day of the year, take your worst case scenario in the middle of summer, the sun is already behind the house. And I'm going to show you why you can rely on our model for accuracy. If you look at this image, this was taken in, I think this was very late September, because you could see they're still green, right? That's the angle of the sun from behind. This is the middle of the day. This is like 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And you could already see that the sunlight here, I don't know how well you could see it with this resolution, but that's, I took the exact same angle here. And you could see, well, it's lost. You could see it better in your 11 by 17, but if you see the angle of the sun on this fence somewhere,
you're right. It doesn't. The sun is. It's.
It has no relevance. I promise you. That's the whole design of this was to try to.
No, because it's going from. It's.
Yeah. It's behind the houses.
It's behind the houses.
And,
you're right.
And I just wanted to add that we purposely. So, right, three buildings over. Okay. They recently approved two stories and an addition on the roof. When speaking with our client, we said, don't do the addition on the roof. That casts a far larger shadow on the rear yard.
Right, because it's
than
the
what
south
we're
side.
Proposing. By stepping this back, you get virtually no sunlight blocked for any of our.
Okay. Are there questions? Any questions? All right, we can go to discussion. I think in just terms of the bulk and the form, I don't think there's anything that. I'm hard-pressed to say that this is not appropriate. I think it seems like a very reasonable enlargement. We've seen plenty in other neighborhoods that have been much larger, and I think they've shown us the context of this particular block, and it's very consistent with other enlargements in the rear. So my only comment is, yes, we could tweak it, and you know, it's again, it's more sort of an aesthetic thing that I don't like the fin and the color. And I'm sure they could take care of that. But again, as Fred said earlier on, I don't know if we would have sort of redesigned it for them. But that's the only comment I have in terms of making it better. Yes, John?
Perhaps because I'm relatively new to this, and this will come up over and over, I did want to ask you in the positive, what is the scope of our legal authority? Because we've heard everything, issues ranging from light, air, shadows, brick wall effects, extensions as of right, views, coverage of land, private green spaces. What part of this are we obligated to, or allowed to? I mean, it's a legal authority issue, right? And I say that because I'm a lawyer, not an architect. But what are we allowed to consider?
All right, Mark, you would like, yes.
The landmarks law focuses our attention on the physical fabric, the changes to the building itself, and to the changes, how those changes might affect in an historic district significant architectural features of the neighboring buildings. So we have authority to regulate the rear yard, the rear facades of the buildings. But in terms of light and air issues, that's not what we do. We don't review. I mean, for example, we approve blocking up lot line windows all the time. It's not an architectural consideration. And so, with respect to gardens, we don't regulate gardens in the rear of property. We don't regulate plantings. We don't. The short answer to the question is what we regulate is changes to the facades, the rear facades of these buildings, and we look at the effect on the building itself and any impact on the physical facade of the neighboring buildings.
And in the context of its historic significance.
Well, that's as a follow-up, really, though, to this question. And just to ask for further clarification on that, Mark, please. Because the testimony is really compelling, and it will be here over and over again, about the historic nature of the core, of this green core, to the historic district. I mean, what is its contribution, and to what extent do we have a say about limiting the development into these cores? Because otherwise, we can just assume 22 feet cut off the entire perimeter of the core, right? Because one after another, the buildings will enlarge. So
I think that we would look at the scale of the addition to the historic building. That would be the appropriate way to analyze the impact of an addition on the district. Further, that being limited also by zoning, whether the 30-foot rear yard and stuff like that. But that's what we look at. And so the commission has historically looked at whether, you know, a building, a rear yard addition, changed this building from a row house to something else. Putting additions on the top, whether it changed, you know, a four-story building to a six-story building, really changed what this typology was. And so that's what we look at.
So there's
not a historic analysis of the rear of the garden core, because as somebody testified, historically these were utilitarian rear yards, and they were used for utilitarian purposes. So it's sort of apples and oranges, and so we're looking at it now from the context of just the relationship of that addition to the building itself.
But they existed historically. They existed as open spaces. Whether the use was another is another point. They existed as open spaces when they were designated.
They were existed, but they also had different structures in them. They were used for different purposes. They weren't gardens. That's not what they were done. And that's not why they were. These districts were designated for their rear yards.
I'm sorry. Members of the public are not allowed to speak. But I think it's also worthwhile to think about why we designate historic districts. And very often, it is really about sort of the public realm. You know, we're going to be talking about interior landmarks, but it's what people can enjoy and continue to enjoy over time. So very often when we think about changes in historic districts, we talk about visibility, and primarily we talk about visibility from the street. Very often, and I think something that Cristobal had said, which is when there are places which nobody can view from the public realm, they're very often taken care of at staff level. So the issue of the historic nature of the buildings, I think what Mark was talking about, but I think it's very rare where you will ever read a report that talks about the open spaces in the rear. You'll talk about the building typologies, and you'll talk about significant features to those buildings, but there's no basis, or there, that hasn't been the basis for the creation of the district.
Right. But I do think that maybe we are. I mean, so So your proposal is, I think, rather modest, and with respect and as it interfaces with the precedent, is entirely appropriate and reasonable. I do think we might be in a new time for the Landmarks Commission with respect to this, the discussion, and the testimony was, again, very articulate about it, with respect to green streets, to green infrastructure, and to rethinking, you know, what the role is, historic role of these green spaces, while they might have been used for other things, will mean in the future. I mean, you're right.
Right.
In terms of precedent, not, but in terms of future, maybe yes.
Well, I guess there are two things. One is that there's the law itself, which sort of guides us. There are our own designation reports that have been put in place. There is a basis why something has been adopted. And I think to infuse something else is complicated, and also a door opener to many things that we'll be pulled into, which is just not appropriate. So I think that in general, we may find regulations, or not regulations, but testimony compelling. I think if you go anywhere, if you sit on a board, I was at the Board of Standard Appeals for 10 years, there were many things that were very compelling, but the jurisdiction of the board is limited. And we did not comment on aesthetics, which, you know, that's really Landmarks that does something like that. So I think when we look at government overall, we have to recognize that different agencies have different roles, and I think the members of the public have to understand that themselves. And I think that we as a body should be true to what our jurisdiction is. Okay, yes. Michael, yes.
I'll chime in with my own experience here and how it relates to this issue. Prospect Heights is a new district, and it's a district that has some really remarkable brownstone blocks that are very intact and very unblemished, if that's the unbiased word to use, by developments in the rear courts, and the district falls on a spectrum of New York blocks as a morphology between very, very rigid formal courts, Bell Nord, something like that, and interior courts that have virtually disappeared, like much of the Upper East Side. And I think that personally, my view on how to judge something appropriate or not appropriate within that spectrum is to look at the spectrum. Where does the block fit on that spectrum? And how are you changing the historic sense of place that this district was created for? I think that there have been some blocks in Prospect Heights that have appeared while I've been here that have been totally pristine or virtually totally pristine. And for them, it seemed to me like there are some in Harlem as well that are like super clean blocks where it's just completely repetitive and very, very uniform. For me, that's a heavier lift where you're the first guy on the block who wants to go and do something different. I think that imposes a higher burden. Not to say that it's not appropriate and that we have standards that allow for homeowners to modify their homes and bring them into modern standards while maintaining the overall historic character of the district. I think that in this case, the applicant has shown and the staff has confirmed to me that there have been, in the short history of this district, several applications on this block that have been approved for incursions into the block of one or two stories, and that there is already, either by dint of bad decisions in the past were before the district, or just the normal way that these blocks develop, there have been incursions, whether they are decks, sheds, built structures, one story, two stories, four stories. This is not a pristine block, and therefore, I think that the question of whether or not an addition can go one or two stories within to that block is not unacceptable to me. And I think that such that the massing and general extension of this proposal is appropriate by those standards. That said, I think the owner has heard a large number of his neighbors who are opposed to it, and that would be really, I think, wise for him to consider that in making his plans. But that's not part of our job here to weigh in on those. You know, if a guy wants to do something that's going to make all of his neighbors hate him, that's his business. It's his right to do it. I think that from my perspective, as we've talked about, the general focus is on the aesthetic appropriateness of the proposed work to the historic quality of the district and the place. I think that what draws this away from being as appropriate as it could be are two factors that have been touched on by others. Number one, the overhangs, while maybe it's a good idea from the long-term preservation of the window systems, is something that clearly is not required, is not even considered normative in many locations throughout New York City, in most locations throughout New York City, and they add to the lack of contextualism of the proposed addition. And they also happen to make your neighbors mad by extending the thing unnecessarily into the back. I would suggest that the overhangs be reconsidered. Second, I think that the gray wall in a project that is distinguished in its kind of monomaniacal focus on function and kind of sun issues is an aesthetic gesture that looks out of place to me in what is otherwise a utilitarian addition. I think it should be reconsidered. And I think lastly, I think the fenestration, while we generally allow for a lot of variation in fenestration at the rear, this happens to have 7 different kinds of sizes, types of windows in a very small addition. I think that it would benefit from being studied to make it a little bit more quiet, contextually appropriate.
I somehow the fenestration doesn't bother me at all. It seems to be falling within the rhythms of the building, and even if they are varied, it doesn't seem that they're. It reads in a chaotic manner at all. At the lower levels, you have more transparency. You go to the next level, it's a little bit less, and then you go to the top floors. So I think there's a hierarchy to it that seems to make sense. Yes.
I was asking Mark, I don't want to go on with this donut thing too long, but to me, the overriding issue would be whether or not a particular donut was included in a designation report. And if the donuts were not broadly something that was investigated, then perhaps the commission needs to go back and review that and add them to designations perhaps. But that's all an aside. Our mission, as Michael said, is to review the aesthetic appropriateness of something. And for me, this is, frankly, one of the more thoughtful applications that I've seen since I've been here. I've never seen someone actually take into consideration their neighbors when they're putting one of these things up. I am not an anti-stucco light by a long shot, because people have been applying stucco to buildings since they were able to mix dirt and mud. I find this one slightly jarring. I understand the reason for it. Your discussion of the structural necessity. It's almost as if I would like to see you investigate perhaps another color, so it's not so jarring. With regard to the overhangs, I was standing. I left my umbrella on a cab the other day. Yesterday, and I was standing under an overhang in a building, and for the first time I just thought, man, I'm glad they have these overhangs and awnings on some buildings. And so I can understand that completely. I also understand it from a solar gain perspective. And so those are the two issues I have with this thing. I think this is extremely appropriate.
Other comments? Yes,
Chris? Just think that they're a combination of concerns, I think. And for me, one of the most compelling remarks I heard was to refer to the donut as the commons. It's not really a commons. If all the neighbors took their fences out, then it might be the commons. But just as the architect spent much care with this aspect of the sunlight, the view is important. And as Mark pointed out, if we consider the scale of this addition, I think it is overscaled, but it's close. But the whole this aspect of the donut and the commons, and it's an important feature. And I think if we can keep as much of it as possible, the fenestration I think is fine. But I do think putting 22 feet on this building is too much.
Okay. Other comments? Yes.
I think, from the presentation in the beginning, it seemed that this could be appropriate if certain changes were made. And I think, though, hearing some of the comments from the audience, it reminds me of some discussions that we had more of years ago when we talked more about the interior porch, and we talked more about what's inside the donut. And I think that one of the things that we did occasionally was to analyze the addition based on how pristine or how well used that donut area is. Here we don't really know, and we do see fences, and so it's not, I think, something that we can say. It's been said before, it doesn't seem to be that we're saying that this is a very pristine commons or court. But I think that it has value, and I think that the fact that people are testifying means that it has value to them. But in that regards, I think that we also look at what is appropriate in terms of what we've approved before and what a homeowner has the right to expect that they can do to their building. So I think that this building, that this addition, while close to appropriate, if it had certain changes in my view, if the overhang wasn't there, that then necessitated the walls on the edges coming out, that would make it more appropriate. And I think that we've made lots of decisions about sizes of projections of additions into the rear, just based on how it worked with other additions or lack of other additions and this core. And so I think it should be used here too. Which, in my opinion, just means that this could be altered, needs to be drawn in some way. Right. It could be appropriate.
I mean,
the issues.
Right. I think one of the things that sort of maybe I come with as a planner, since that's my background, is that I think you have many districts in the city where homeowners and property owners are allowed to do certain things. I think as a preservation commission, we should be flexible to allow people in historic districts to do things where everywhere else in the city they can do. If it doesn't erode preservation goals, then we should allow it. So I think, back to what I think Michael had said and Mark had said, and we can think about this in the future when we think about historic districts, about what are the features that we want to maintain. For better or for worse, the districts that have been adopted and have not recognized these gardens as an important, significant historic feature, I think we should allow flexibility. And I think I understand the concerns of neighbors, because very often they don't want things to change because it takes something away from them. But I think in general, if we as an agency would like to continue to have historic districts, I think it's important to allow people within those historic districts to do things where everywhere else in the city they can do. So that's sort of a general comment. It's my sort of philosophy on this. But why don't we sort of wrap this up? I know, Chris, you have concerns. You think that this is, the Balkan form is...
I think it's close, but I just think it's overscaled at the moment for the first floor. That's 22 feet.
Right, even though that there's several others that are as deep as that.
Well, it has an impact on the three or four neighbors to the left and to the right.
All right, how do the other commissioners feel in terms of, I mean, we can tweak this. I think one of the things that we can ask the applicant to do is clearly the color of the stucco can change very easily to a color which doesn't call attention to itself, and they can work with staff on that. I think it can be cut back because, you know, it's a fin, and you don't see fins elsewhere. I personally don't have a problem with the recess itself as a way to make the home, screened from some of the elements. But I know some of you do have, but if we really need to, we can ask them to cut that back as well, although I don't think it's absolutely necessary. But I'm just curious, are the other commissioners on board with that? Are there, yes? Okay, and do we feel strongly about making them take away the recess and cutting that back?
I would like them to.
All right, yes, do you want to say something?
I was just gonna say, the gray of the wall, it is much lighter somehow printing than what was intended. It was supposed to be a lot darker. And then I just wanted to say, in terms of the recesses, one of the main reasonings that, you know, if you took the 20 feet that everyone talks about, that's really the wing walls. The actual rear is 18 feet. And it's a funny thing, because if we had built the recess out to the 20 feet like everyone else did, I don't think anyone would talk about it. And so what we purposely did was say, 20 feet is just those two, you know, and honestly, in FAR, it's more valuable for the client, right, to come out those extra feet. Our argument was, let's break up this facade some, bring it back, get these overhangs to protect you while not taking even the 20 feet, because the vast majority of that wall is not even 20 feet, it's 18. And the last other thing, you can't tell from this, but part of our reasoning here is that if you look, right there in the corner is open to below. So part of the idea is to take any excess runoff anytime it rains and the green roof doesn't absorb it, and it actually just drips down this wall and into the pool. And so that was part of the design of this, was to allow for any excess runoff that we're going to use almost as a capturing device sloping towards that.
Well, if you, how deep is your recess? It looks like it's 2 feet or something.
Yeah, it's 2 feet.
But if you make it much, you know, you could make it less so it feels more like a recess and not really, I mean, just as an articulation here, as opposed to...
You mean this piece right here?
Yes.
Yeah.
On both sides.
Well, we actually have cut it, but we cut it back since the community planning board, just hearing, really meeting with the neighbor, and we cut it
right, but you could cut it back by 1 foot, and that would may still be fine. It'll just reduce the entire bulk, and maybe Chris would even support it because you're cutting it back.
Yeah, you're talking about this here? Yeah, we could. Yeah.
All right, so it's okay to say that we will work with staff. They will cut it back. Chris, you're on board with that? Okay, and the color, I think they can look at the palette.
I think that, by the way, we're very open.
Okay, does that seem fine? Okay, good. We'll close the hearing. Okay, and we can read the resolution. Diana, would you like to read that, please?
In the matter of a certificate of appropriateness, Borough Brooklyn, 203 Prospect Place, Prospect Heights Historic District, Lot 1151, Lot 66. Application is to construct a rear yard addition and alter the front area way. I recommend approval with modifications, finding that the proposed alteration will not cause the destruction of any significant architectural historic fabric, that the proposed rear yard addition will not be visible from a public thoroughfare, that rear yards on this block are particularly deep, and the proposed rear yard addition will not substantially eliminate the presence of a rear yard, that the two-story height of the addition will be consistent with the height of the other additions on the block, that other additions in the block project as deeply into the rear yard. Therefore, the proposed addition will not diminish the central green space. That the irregular massing of the addition will help reduce the apparent size of the addition, thereby respecting the adjacent buildings which do not have rear yard additions. That the design of the rear facade will maintain the scale and character of the building as an individual row house. And that the proposed area weight changes will be consistent with other areaways in the streetscape and compatible with the special architectural and historic character of the building and the historic district. However, that the applicant will work with the staff regarding the color of the stucco and will reduce the pullback. It says the planar wall? The two side walls will be moved back further so as to make the addition more compatible with the historic district.
All in favor?
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, this application's been approved. We'll take a break for lunch for till 1:30.
Okay. Hey.
Thank you.